I'm hoping the rest of the afternoon, as we said, is about STS, the operations, equipment, and further on areas. I hope it's lively enough to keep us all engaged and having lots of input. A little bit of a change to the schedule. I know you see Captain Matthew's tag. It's actually not. It's Captain Apostolos Skempes from Acadia Ship Management. Captain Skempes is a master mariner. He had 15 years of sea service, 4 years as master on tankers. He's a professor he served as professor of maritime studies at the Merchant Marine Academy. And between March 2000 and 2012, he holds a master's degree, an MBA in shipping from Piraeus University. He's a certified trainer on bridge simulators and ICTS in transits. He's a certified auditor and has, since November 2012, was appointed as training manager for Acadia Ship Management. Captain Skempes will be discussing the risk and reputation of tanker operators. Please welcome Captain Skempes.
So, good afternoon, everybody. We would like to congratulate the organizers for this event. It's interesting, it's successful. Thank you for inviting us here. Unfortunately, our managing director, Captain Dimitrios Matheou, and also chairman of Green Award organization, was not able to attend, so I'm here. I will have this presentation. I will go through some parts that already have been discussed, and I will just focus on some other parts which I would like to draw your attention, and maybe they will create a discussion after that. If you fall asleep during my presentation, I will think that it's due to the lunch and not due to not being interesting of what I say. So I will say, okay, he had or she had a lot, she ate a lot, so she fell asleep. So don't worry, I won't be offended. Acadia Ship Management operates 13 tankers. It's 9 Aframax and 4 Suezmax. And we have 6 more Suezmaxes coming within this year, up to the end of 2016, beginning of 2017. We have quite a lot ship-to-ship operations. And so some issues that we will discuss here have arisen or will become known to us through these operations. Let's see first what is the concerns, let's say, about this operation for the operator. And of course, first concern is safety and the responsibility that we have. We have to ensure safety for our own vessel, and on the same time, we have to ensure that participating vessel and also the other parties, service providers, are also comply with this. We have the nominating of a vessel, but many times it's not just one vessel, so I have a message here from some operation, which was 7 vessels that we had to screen, and sometimes it's 4, sometimes it's 5, sometimes it's more. And then the operator has to do it within a day, or the best, in at best, up to the next day. So they have a lot to do. Then we have the one who is responsible for safety for the operation, and this is the master, and this is totally master's responsibility. And the actions of this, the third parties, should not compromise the safety, as already been discussed. So operator from the side of the office, of the head office, and the masters on the vessels have to perform the proper and detailed planning for STS operation according to policies, according to procedures. The risk assessment, of course, which already have been discussed before here, and according to the results of the risk assessment to introduce this mitigating measures in order that all operation should go okay. And when we do a risk assessment, the first thing we do is hazard identification in order to go on with this process and find what are the measures we're going to take. We will discuss a little bit about this. What we can see here in this photograph is, it's an ERMIS. We can see here, usually, some part of the crew. You see him here, so mostly it's catering crew that they go out of the accommodation and they just want to take a look at the action. He goes out without helmet, he goes out maybe with soft shoes, so we have here a ERMIS situation. Maybe he goes out also with a mobile phone in order to monitor the action. Maybe, and the mobile phone, of course, is not intrinsically safe. Material like this is what we circulate on our vessels in order to be used for training purposes or to be discussed also in during the safety committee meetings of monthly, which are done monthly. Now, for each one who has taken part in a risk assessment seminar, the first thing that they say about the hazard identification is this one, that the most important aspect of shipping safety analysis and safety measurements is to know what risks mariners face in terms of hazards. We all hear this if we go in any, all we learn about this if we go in any risk assessment seminar. So an overlooked hazard is likely to introduce more errors into the overall risk estimate than an inaccurate consequence or a probability estimation. I'm referring to this overlooked hazard because at the end of this presentation, we have a kind of a case study about an overlooked hazard, or something we did not take notice. And furthermore, with the whilst errors in consequence and probability estimation can possibly cancel each other out, an omission in hazard identification will invariably result to the underestimation of the risk. All this is more or less known for all of us who are doing the risk assessment process. So there are unknown factors, especially about third parties to the masters when they are not experienced. And we can see also in this picture here, you can see the aftermost fender where it's been supported. The others are in closed chocks, but this point here, we can discuss about it a little bit, or the service providers can give us their opinion. It's not necessarily wrong, but how can a master have the experience to justify this one, just to approve or to accept this one? What they can do is just as it's been done here in this occasion for our company is that they give the report. They say, we saw this on the other vessel, inform us if it's accepted or whatever it is, so they know for the next time or if this may happen to our own vessel. So its master deals with the second vessel with unknown STS experience to him, and with the service provider, again with unknown level of quality policies for the master, and their competence is an unknown factor for our masters or for the master of the other vessel. And then, as it was also have been before discussed, there is no contract. So this is the contractual issues. There is no contract between participants. Therefore, the only way to ensure safety is through due diligence, and two words that have been also referred here. So to sum up quickly, implementing and following ship-to-ship policies and procedures. So this is what a prudent tanker operator in STS operation should be doing, implementing ship-to-ship policy procedures, of course, have the STS operation plan, employing training experienced personnel, carrying out a thorough risk assessment, seeking information and evaluation of all other parties involved. Now, due diligence, some definitions that with a quick search through the web can take. Why I'm referring to due diligence? It's the two beloved words of Mr. Perisakis and Mr. Glikas. they mostly refer to this one. I believe that the first beloved word of them is dynamarine, but the two combined beloved words is due diligence. since the first time they came to our company, and most of the time when we discuss, due diligence is always emerging, for the right reason, of course. So just a quick look. Cambridge English Dictionary, action that is considered reasonable for people to be expected to take in order to keep themselves, others, and their property safe. Very well. Then, two other definitions, the care that the reasonable person exercises to avoid harm to other persons or their property, and research and analysis of a company or organization done in preparation for a business transaction, from Merriam and Webster. And the last one, which I put as the last one in order that stays to our mind, duty of the operators and officers to gather all necessary information on actual or potential risks involved in a transaction, from Business Dictionary. So we have operators, we have officers. I like very much this definition. It suits my purpose. So let's see about due diligence quickly. From policy and procedures, taking into account the manual, IMO manual on pollution, and of course, as it was referred before, the transfer guide, ship-to-ship transfer guide. Not only this one, of course, when we are doing policies and procedures, or when we are amending, we are taking consideration of, and we are dealing with many legislation, laws, industry practices, and everything. And then we have the risk assessment. Due account should be taken of the estimated duration and complexity of the operation, and an assessment be made of the additional workloads associated with the activity. The aim should be to ensure that all personnel remain fatigue-free and that minimum rest periods are, as required by applicable legislation, are complied with. Again, this refers, it's not only this for risk assessment, but this refers to this case study that I am going to present at the end. I'm always referring to this case study. I'm trying to keep you that you are waiting for something at the end to happen. So more of this at the last stage of this presentation. Let's go on. Proper and detailed planning. We have preparedness that should aim both to the ship and the crew. That's important. Operators, of course, to support the masters with technical advice. Before, in the morning, it was discussed that the more we have experience, the more we can deal with these operations. Like when you said, when you were discussing about the nighttime of operations, and then they say, okay, now we don't do so many nighttime operations, but if we have more feedback, then we can make our risk assessments and the procedures, and then we can go on for the nighttime. Still, for our company, is something that we don't happily agree for the nighttime operations. If we can, we avoid to do it. Crew experience, of course, plays a vital role for the proper execution of a safe STS operation. And STS with similar size vessel require a thorough preparation because there are issues about that. And from what we can see on our company, most of STS operations are done with similar size vessels. Then we have the evaluation of the third party, that we have to, as operators, must have procedures to allow for the evaluation of service provider and the person of overall command. Experience of the service provider in PAWC is of paramount importance, and the level of quality of the service provider should be ascertained prior to the STS operation, of course. After that, there are a lot of issues if we don't do that. The self-assessment, we have to plan and execute procedural and gear assessment and training. Procedures, but also the gear, our assets, which are the vessels, the crew, all this, so that we can have feedback upon vessels' preparedness for STS. And towards third parties, what we can do, reporting shipping accidents and associated incidents during ship-to-ship operations, providing and retaining seaboard oil speak preparedness and response capacity, the equipment, but also the knowledge of the crew to operate this equipment. Continuous evaluation of STS third-party service providers, monitoring and control of STS-involved ships, keeping on-fleet STS data and statistics. We can show a lot of statistics through our operations, but the intention is not to show how good we are. All companies, they try to be good, and they have to be. But anyway, we can see that although we have very good results, something had escaped our attention, also from the other parties. The evaluation of our vessels has been very good. And then for about SPS XTS experience, quality of adopted policies and procedures with respect to STS gain experience becomes an asset to the company, ensuring safety. All this is known to everybody. So let's go to this case study. This is something that has skipped our attention at that time. I call it a sunny day, all day long. So we have, back in May of 2014, we had two STS operations, 22 and 24, and then the second month, 27 to 29 of May, in Honningsvåg, Norway. So where is this? It's a little bit north. It's up there. So the ST area position is 70. North of north. It's a lot north. So this sunny day, how many hours it is? Mostly of the 24 hours, it's the sunny day. So when we did our risk assessment at that time, there has been an unidentified hazard. What this was? It was the insomnia. Most of you will remember this movie. Remember an Al Pacino who was sleepless after some days, and his judgment was not as it should be, the reactions, and then by trying to chasing Robin Williams, he made mistakes and everything. He had doubts and everything. So the same thing was after the operations. The operations went very well, but after that, our master reported about this finding. So although work and rest hours requirements had been complied with, watch schedule was normal for all crew, no overtime requirements to these operations, and manning of vessel is above required for all our vessels. Master reported that some crew members showed signs of insufficiency and laziness simply because people went to rest but did not manage to sleep. So after that, we consider also this factor in our risk assessment. But when we have to do a risk assessment up there, we have to take into consideration that maybe some crew members will face this thing. We thought that people are getting rest, but actually they are not. Or they don't go to sleep. Of course, they go to the cabin, or they don't have watch to do or other duties, but actually they are not resting as as properly should be. And then this was something that was added to this to the risk assessment process. So there's always room for improvement, and although we can say, yes, we are experienced and we have very good results, always we have to look further and try to see what's going on. Now, this came out because masters and officers are encouraged to report anything, and also that there's a review going on after an operation, which is very important. Not always saying that, okay, we went through the timetable and we did not had any ROB from after the operation, so everything is okay. But also we try and we encourage all our crew members to report anything that has gone to their attention or anything unusual. So I believe we're okay. Thank you very much. We can discuss if you want something.
Do we have any questions from the floor?
Yeah. Captain, do you employ more crew on company policy or just?
Company policy is that we are above manning anyway, not because of STS operation, but always we are above, with one more second officer, one more third engineer, and always is double watches for AB and OS, which also the OS is experienced as a part of being able to do some assisting duties on the bridge. So we are above manning, always, not only for STS. Yes, please. What to do about this? Yes, this is what also our consideration, and we just said that we have to take this under consideration and then just to try and give an order or to plan that the crew is not getting involved with more operation like a planned maintenance system, but only what is necessary. So prior to any operation that will take place in such an area, we try to keep them not with so many tasks. But I don't believe we don't find something more to do, but just to have it in mind and always be aware, the master and or the chief engineer, about that. Yes, please.
How do you name it, this
hazard,
your risk system? How
do
you place it
on your system? Yes, we name it as arrest. I will describe now. It's a resting period not been adequate due to insomnia.
For this one.
Sir? Yes.
How do we manage when you have commercial pressure again with the crew, for example? back in, like for example, we have a trade between Houston and Japan, vessels usually cross the Panama Canal, and they usually do an SDS with another ship that is doing going to Asia. The vessel transit the Panama Canal 14, sometimes 15 hours, the crew is working, the whole crew, they exit the Panama Canal and immediately they have an SDS operation. How the captain can manage, you know, resting period of the crew, you know, they've been through this whole, you know, transit, and then they have to do this, the SDS as a service provider. The problem here is not you providing the service, it's that the crew on the vessel is not ready, they don't have that preparedness to do. So, you know, this can cause accident, not for the service provider, but the same crew, you know, is not ready for this type of operation.
Yeah, can we switch off the microphones and I can give you an answer? Because, anyway, no, I don't want to switch off the microphones. The best thing, it's not good. The best thing is that you have to plan the operation, giving some time for rest. But you know it's not always possible on the vessel. It's not only for STS operation. We discussed about Rotterdam. We all know how much time is the standing by time for a tanker to go to Rotterdam and already having sailed through the English Channel and then going inside and having a discharging operation with a vetting inspector also. So it's not only for STS. We face that. The issue of work and rest hours, we face it if we want to be true and real. We face it on vessels. We try, I guess all of us, we try to arrange the schedule as much suitable. But it's not always that we comply. I don't want to lie, this now is written already, it's worldwide. I'm not the first one who declares, so anyway.
Yeah.
Uh, Actually, from my part of, I cannot help in this one. Maybe an operator or a charterer could answer this question. Now, for me, I have seen the results of some operations that go beyond required timetable. But that's all. I cannot answer
there
to,
are two
you,
ways
to this one.
Okay. There are two ways to address.
Sorry, can I just ask, is there members of press in the room?
There are.
Yeah,
so
okay.
Maybe this is a conversation we should take offline.
No, it's we're not here to hide something, okay? We're not here to hide behind our finger.
So there are two ways. One way is to perform the operation and violate possibly the resting hours.
Yeah.
And the other way is to demand for 5, 6, 7 hours a resting period for the crew. Because all the STS clauses are referring to OCMF guidelines. So one of the OCMF guidelines is to provide adequate resting hours for the crew. So you can grab this clause, and depending how strong you feel, okay, in your relation to the charter, and demand resting hours. Regards my company, we have tried both ways.
So your company is your
running tankers. So, but I can assure you, in 90% of our efforts to secure resting hours for our crew are successful with charters.
Thanks.
Yeah, because they cannot provide, of course, something reasonable. The example of a gentleman provided is quite reasonable. When the crew is exhausted, then surely you can demand 6 hours of resting for the crew. Nobody would deny. Probably you will face a problem when the malaise analyst of the same company of the charterers will come back 3-4 months later and will say, okay, we don't recognize this time. But again, it's worth the fight and the battle and all the effort it was.
Going back to your presentation, you mentioned that you monitor and control the STS service providers. So how are you monitoring the STS service providers, and what are you looking for? What are your key KPIs that you're focusing on?
Yes, actually we're doing this through the DYNAMARINe services. So we are getting, the way to monitor is that each provider is being assessed. So we are doing the assessment, and we send this assessment to this database. So from there on we can get assessment also from other previous operations.
So when you say
we are
you're
using,
assessing,
yeah.
Is it the vessel's masters or is it the officers?
Yeah, the master.
So the masters who
the
are there having that relationship at
assesses,
the time.
Assesses also the provider and the POOC, POAC and all that. With this photo I am using here, it was also from one assessment of our master who sent this photo and say, what is this one? Is it safe or not? About this aftermost fender we saw. But anyway, I would like to go back to this gentleman, and there's not something to hide. I used the word planning, and this is what we do. This is how we address it in our company when we are occupying more crew than the normal. Always, not only for some operations. No matter the trade of the vessels, in all our vessels the crew is more over the manning, and also not to trying not to have operations at night. So even this one can provide some hours more for the crew according to the voyage. It's not always feasible.
Sorry, one more thing from your presentation I picked up. You mentioned at the beginning about the fact that most of your STS are with similar sized vessels and that you find that a particular risk. How are you monitoring that risk, or how do you manage that risk? What do you take into consideration? How do you make sure you've considered all areas?
Yeah, well, at first we know what is the risks when you have a vessel of the same size in terms of the wings of the bridge and some other issues. So these are all addressed. These are all reminding to the masters, as you saw in one part of the presentation. There is a lot of feedback to the master before the operation. So when we see from the assessment of the vessel prior to the operation the dimensions and any other particularities, all these are addressed to the master.
And is that a tool you have internally, or is that a third-party tool that you're using as a risk assessment to validate the size of the
Yeah, the, initially it was our risk assessment, but through the work of DynaMarine, we have improved, let's say, the services. And we're always trying to improve. That's why I told you this was a serious consideration for us. We said, oops, we never thought about that factor, the insomnia thing.
Thanos.
Just a quick one. So obviously you're established as a service provider. You know the business quite well. You know the capability of your crew and your ships. You have, I believe, an established sort of step-by-step procedure that you follow.
Yeah.
And you issue questionnaires as form of risk assessment. You said maybe for me it doesn't read exactly this assessment, but it's you issue a questionnaire to the crew and the captain or the ship operator that is coming to do the operations. How much time you actually allow prior to the operation for this place? Because you mentioned something same day operation, and obviously nobody, even the best risk assessor, cannot assess anything who knows very well within that given time.
Yeah. It's an issue I have not thought about how much time we need to do. Usually there is time, but maybe sometimes it's something we have to consider about this. Really, it's very interesting.
Checklist
this one.
It's a very mechanical thing.
Yeah.
Sometimes we check it without actually having time to think what we check.
Mm-hmm.
So
exactly.
That's my first part of the question. The second part of the question, which is really for my lacking of your industry understanding. Have you found yourself, and does the contract allow for you to do that, in a case where you are actually have to undertake a ship-to-ship operation with a ship who maybe its crew is not up to scratch with this type of operation, or they are lower number than one you expected, or the operation is difficult because of the weather, and have you found yourself, or can you do it by contract, to provide helping personnel on the other side? Something, by the way, that the mothership in LNG operation, during the first two contracts, the first two attempts, always does by contract. So we never allow the ship to do it on its own. We put people there to show them and be careful, plan operation. Is this industry allowed that, your contract allowed that?
No, okay. I don't believe so. Never heard about that, but...
I believe so, no.
If you can possibly...
So whatever they know on the other side.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, this is what how it goes.
What you mean is to connect the...
Yes. For the
cost of
taking, the long way.
Yeah. Not going to the operation, but the ship.
Which is included in a normal operational manual for an LNG.
Always connected.
Interesting. Okay. Thank you very much.
Any other questions?
It's not really a question, but I think that this gentleman here raised this thing about fatigue going through the Panama Canal and then having to go straight to an STS operation, and how should that be handled? And I think we left that kind of hanging in the air.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's important to consider that there are two people that can stop this any time that they want. The ISM code puts the onus on the master. If he thinks anything is unsafe, he can just stop and drop the anchor or do whatever. If the master feels under pressure, then he should contact his DPA. And the DPA then is legally obliged to support the master, to make sure that the master's claims are genuine, and then to stop the operation. As a master, I've done it a few times. I've just stopped everything and sent everybody to bed. And I have a terminal saying, you've got to get off, the tugs are coming. I said, no, everybody's going to bed, we're not moving for 6 hours. As a DPA, I've also done that. I've ordered a ship to go to anchor when a master called me with a similar thing. So I think that whenever you're facing this kind of situation as a ship operator, you're legally obliged to stop everything and just get everybody to get some rest. And whatever happens within the terms of your charter party is one thing, but if you were to go and do that SDS operation without properly rested crew, then the consequences will be far more than 12 hours off hire.
Okay.
And indeed, through vetting inspections, many times they have asked the master to identify where it's written on the policies this master's overriding authority. Mm-hmm. So that to find out that he knows that he has this authority and that the also company defines this authority. So you are right about that.
Coming as a member of the press, I think that there is a big issue who overrides the other side. My side, your side. But there are then commercialities, ill-thought commercialities, wearing my former Seabrook's hat, that major companies do not understand. They play fool. They don't want to know. And that comes against the interests of the owner. But above that interest is the well-being of the master and the crew. So this is something this meeting must address strongly, being also in a legal entity's amphitheater.
Of course.
So we have to address this properly, because people sometimes, worldwide, all seafarers, sometimes they're afraid because they might lose their job. Correct me if I'm wrong.
Yeah, that's quite right.
So these are important issues that have to be addressed, and some people in the office should not be more royal than the royals.
Yeah,
this is an important issue. So we have to address this, and this must become a regulation.
Well, it is a regulation in that the DPA.
The implementation is what counts.
Yeah.
Laws are laws
yeah.
to be implemented.
Well, the laws are there. It's in STCW that the crew must be rested. But the master might feel commercially pressurized to go ahead with it, but if he does feel concerned, then at least he has the DPA to call. And once it goes to the DPA, his route is straight to the top. He doesn't have to go through any line management.
And also the master should get rest, huh?
Of course.
Because we are talking now that we are over the manning, but we are over the manning in other ranks, not the master. We don't have two masters. So the master also need to get some sleep, not to think that he is a god.
I think this has been very valid. We do have to move on for
okay.
time-wise.
Thank you
again,
very much.
Mrs.
Thank
Skempes.
You, everybody.